Welcome to C3 Church. We're so excited that you've decided to join us for church on this Memorial Day weekend. And right now, we just want to take a moment to honor all of those people who have sacrificed their lives in defense of our country and in defense of our freedom. And if you're a family member of someone who has sacrificed their lives, we want to honor you as well. And just take a moment to remember all of those who have passed. Right now, if you're in a watch party, we're just so excited that you're joining us. And if you would like to be involved in a watch party, then you can go to c3church.com to sign up. But watch parties are just our way of bringing church to you. It's our way of being able to connect, being able to lean in with others and have that same community that we would have even though we can't meet on a Sunday morning. And so if you'd like to get involved in a watch party, go ahead and jump and do that. And then also, if you have kids at home, we want to let you know that we have some incredible resources to get your kids involved and to bring Jesus to them on their level. So you can either go to our website, c3church.com/c3kids, or go to the C3 Kids YouTube page. But before we jump into service, I just want to give you a quick rundown of what service is going to look like. First, we're going to be able to lean in through worship. We're going to be able to press into God, and we're just believing that He's going to move in this time. And so I want to encourage you just to stand, whatever you feel comfortable doing, just press into God during that time of worship. And then we're going to hear an incredible message from Pastor Martha. And so grab your journal or your notebook, something to take notes on, and go ahead and get that out. And let's really lean in during this time, because I believe that this message is really going to impact you and it's going to change your life. So let's lean in and let's worship God.
Good morning, church. We are so excited that you made the decision to worship with us this morning. So wherever you are, stand up and let's sing together.
There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's robe as He walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises He hears. The sound I love to hear, it's the sound of the Savior's robe as He walks into the room where people pray, where we hear worship.
Hell begin to shake. Oh, hail the Lord. Oh, hail.
the King of glory yet to live.
Falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. And I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, oh. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. In every war he wages, he will win. I'm not backing down from any giants, 'cause I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story ends. And I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, 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 oh. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Come on, sing this out. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. 'Cause you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. And I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. So you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. So you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Victory in your name. It doesn't matter what situations we're facing. It doesn't matter what battles may be going on around us, Lord. We know that we have victory in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you, Father, that when we lay down our weapons, Father, you take over. So, Father, we surrender to you now. We give you everything in this moment. Come on, church, can we just sing that one more time?
And I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you,
Lord. Come on, no matter what you're going through.
And I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory.
Come on, declare it over every battle you're facing.
For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
We love you, Lord. We thank you that we walk in victory today in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
What a powerful time of worship we just got to experience. And isn't it awesome that, you know, we need to experience victory right now so we get to worship and just speak that into existence this morning. Right now, though, we're going to transition into our time of giving back to God through our tithes and offerings. And I just want to say thank you for your generosity. Thank you for continuing to give during this time, because not only have we continued to be able to impact missions locally, but we've also been able to continue impacting missions internationally. Even though our team was unable to travel to Guatemala this year, we've still been able to give financially and to provide food resources to children who are in need in Guatemala, which has been awesome. And so again, we just want to say thank you for your generosity. But here at C3, we have four different ways that you can give. You can go to our website and go to c3church.com/give. You can also go to our app, C3 Church NC app, and you can give on there as well. You can drop it off here in the cafe, or you can go ahead and you can mail it to us. But right now, we're going to transition into our time of hearing an incredible message from Pastor Martha. And we're so excited for this word and what it's going to bring and what it's going to do in your life. So just grab a notebook, grab a pen, get ready to take notes, and let's lean in and see what God can do through this message.
Well, hi, and welcome to C3 Church. We're so excited you guys are joining us today. And as we get started, I just want to take a minute to say thank you to C3 Church and our friends because you are so generous and so faithful, we are able just to help not only people in our area, but around the world. And this time of year, we usually take a team to Guatemala, to kind of a forgotten village. And last week they reached out to us, and we found out that they were actually starving, that they have no food in their village. And so because of your generosity, we were able to send them food and provide food for them. So we just want to say thank you. Thank you for being the hands and feet of Jesus wherever he sends us, that we have the opportunity to make an impact. And as we get started today, I just want to share, you know, a couple of weeks ago, I wrote a book, Moving Forward, and it was released and released on Amazon. And the reason I wrote a book was because if we were to have coffee or if we were to talk, this is what I would want to share with you. These are life principles that I think everybody needs to live by. And, you know, I wanted to be able to speak these principles that would go places I would never go. And these words would be able to speak to people I will never have the opportunity to meet. And here's the principle of the book. If there is one thing that is going to keep you stuck, it is living in unforgiveness. And so the principles in the book show you how to release unforgiveness and to walk in freedom and to walk in healing and wholeness. Because see, we live in an age of offense. Offense is defined as something that outrages the moral or physical senses. Let me say that again. An offense is defined in Webster's dictionary as something that outrages the moral or physical senses. So let me ask you this. How often do you find yourself getting offended? See, an offense is an emotional response, one that initially we can't help. Someone says or does something that hurts us, or maybe they forgot to do something, or they forgot to say something, and we feel neglected, and so it offends us. And then this day and age, we are so easily offended. And I tell you what, if I'm not carrying an offense of something, I can get offended on your behalf. We just look for opportunities to carry an offense and to get offended. I tell you, in this season of COVID-19, there has been so much offense. I mean, people get offended of, like, do I wear a mask or do I not wear a mask? And people get offended when you wear a mask, and people get offended when you don't wear a mask. Some of you are feeling offended just because I brought up the subject of a mask, and we all have strong opinions about that. People are offended because they think we should open up the country, and then some people are offended because they say we shouldn't be opening up the country. We can get offended by what people wear and things that they say. We get offended by people's choices. We are so easily offended. And I will tell you, in history, this hasn't been the case for the world. Probably 20 years ago, as you look back, people didn't easily get offended. It is something that is happening in our generation. And in Luke 17:1, Jesus says, "It is impossible that no offense should come." In other words, Jesus knows we're all going to get offended. It's an emotional response, but we get to choose if we are going to live offended. See, an offense says, "You hurt me." Living offended says, "I'll never forgive you for that." An offense is an event that happened. Living offended is a decision we make. Offenses are inevitable. We're all going to get offended. But living offended is optional. God's word tells us to love unconditionally, to always forgive, and to do everything within our power to live at peace with everyone. And when we don't follow these principles, it can sever our relationships. And if the world's supposed to know that we are followers of Jesus by our love for one another, we cannot afford to walk around offended at each other, trying to love each other. The world will never go for that. See, offense leads to bitterness. Bitterness leads to unforgiveness. And unforgiveness leads to a severed relationship and possibly even the death of a relationship or extreme hatred. So if we are wise and if we're going to walk in the wisdom of God, we have got to stop this progression of offense before it even starts. Christine Kane says the best piece of advice she ever got was choose not to stay offended. She says, bitterness, offense, disappointment will take you out of your job, your marriage, your family, your ministry, your calling, probably quicker than an immoral relationship. Let me say that again. She says that bitterness, offense, disappointment will take you out of your job, your marriage, your family, your ministry, your calling, probably quicker than an immoral relationship. Offense is going to be the thing that is going to take us out if we don't choose to fight it. If we don't choose to release the offense, it is going to be our destruction. This is why Scripture says in Proverbs 4:23, guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. And so if you allow toxic emotions, offense, bitterness, anger, disappointment, unforgiveness, discouragement, if you allow these things to remain unresolved, then these are going to be the things that sabotage your destiny and your purpose. We have got to get rid of these toxic emotions. And I talk a lot about in my book about how to get rid of the toxic emotions and how to walk in forgiveness, because I think it is so important, because I do believe that offense is going to be the thing that destroys us if we do not come against it. I want us to look at a story in Mark. It's the story of an offended woman and how she chose to live offended. And I want us to look and learn from her outcome. I want us to look at what could have happened if she had made a different choice, if she had chosen to not live offended. So let's look at Mark 6, starting in verse 17. It says, "For Herod himself had given orders to have John arrested, and he had him bound and put in prison. He did this because of Herodias, his brother's Philip's wife, whom he had married. For John had been saying to Herod, 'It is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife.' So Herodias nursed a grudge against John and wanted to kill him. But she was not able to, because Herod feared John and protected him, knowing he to be a righteous and holy man. When Herod heard John, he was greatly puzzled, yet he liked to listen to him. Finally, the opportune time came. On his birthday, Herod gave a banquet for his high officials and military commanders and the leading men of Galilee. When the daughter of Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his dinner guest. The king said to the girl, 'Ask me for anything you want and I'll give it to you.' And he promised her with an oath, 'Whatever you ask, I will give you up to half my kingdom.' She went out and said to her mother, 'What shall I ask for?' 'The head of John the Baptist,' she answered. At once the girl hurried into the king with the request, 'I want you to give me right now the head of John the Baptist on a platter.' The king was greatly distressed, but because of his oath and his dinner guest, he did not want to refuse her. So he immediately sent an executor with orders to bring John's head. That man went and beheaded John in the prison and brought back his head on a platter. He presented it to the girl, and she gave it to her mother. On hearing of this, John's disciples came and took his body and laid it in a tomb." So what we see here is Herodias was married to Philip, and she divorced Philip to marry Philip's brother, Herod. And so what John the Baptist told Herod is he just said, "Hey, it's not, you're in sin by marrying your brother's wife, Herodias." And when he said this to Herod, Herodias got offended. And in verse 19, I want you to notice it says, she nursed a grudge against John and wanted to kill him. She got offended because John the Baptist did not approve of her decision. And when John would tell Herod, "Hey, man, you're living in sin. You're not making wise choices," she became bitter. She refused to forgive John for speaking the truth, which ultimately led to John's death. Now, that is some kind of offense. That is some kind of grudge when we carry it so long that it leads to somebody's death. But how many of us are nursing a grudge and a relationship has been severed, and maybe deep down, we just want them, We want their lives destroyed, or we at least want them to suffer. See, Herodias wanted to kill John the Baptist, but Herod wouldn't kill John. He liked him. And so to please his wife and maybe to kind of satisfy her, he had John thrown in prison. But that wasn't enough for Herodias. See, Herod was intrigued by John, and even with John being in prison, that just meant he had more access to call John in and have John kind of explain the scriptures, and he had opportunity to talk to John. And see, John was full of the Holy Spirit, and he spoke the truth. But I want you to notice that even John speaking the truth, it got him thrown in prison. And yet God was able to still use it for good, because John got to have conversations with Herod about Jesus. And it says Herod didn't really understand all that John was saying, but John was continually presenting the scriptures to him. So here's what happens. Herod has this amazing party full of the who's who, high-level leaders, and everybody's drinking. And Herod had a stepdaughter. His daughter was actually his stepdaughter, his brother's daughter, which made it his niece. So it just gets really complicated, doesn't it? But he had his stepdaughter come in and dance, and it pleased him and his guest, and the emotions were heightened, and in a seductive emotional high, he said that she could ask for anything. He would give her up to half the kingdom, half the kingdom. And Herod had a large kingdom. And Herodias had a moment, because when her daughter came to her, she had a moment to make an influential decision. She could have influenced her daughter. She could have said, let's ask for up to half the kingdom. We can start hospitals. We can feed the hungry. We can clothe the poor. We can build churches. We can build orphanages. We can make a difference in this kingdom. Take up to half the kingdom. But because Herodias was offended, and because she hadn't dealt with her offense, she didn't want half the kingdom. She wanted the head of John the Baptist. And I want you to also notice that the daughter came to her mom for influence to say, Mom, I need help in making this decision. And if we are living offended, when those that we influence come for wisdom and insight, our offense will spill out on them. And we won't be a person of good influence. We will influence people for bad. How are you influencing people? Is it your offense that's coming out, or is it wisdom that is coming out? So she asked for a head. I don't know what was going through her mind when her daughter came and said, hey, this is an opportunity that we have, but I do know quickly she asked for the head of John the Baptist. Let me tell you, when you live offended, nothing will satisfy you. You can have all kinds of heads on your walls. You can have the heads of ex-husbands. You can have the heads of pastors, of leaders, of your boss, of your boyfriends or girlfriends. And I tell you, it won't ever be enough. An offense not dealt with leads to death. In John 10:10, it says, a thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus says, I have come that you may have life and have it to the full. People are not the enemy. Satan is the enemy. And when we nurse something, it means to give it life and to give it your life force. It says that Herodias nursed this grudge. She thought about it every day. Every time she heard his name, she cringed. She nursed this grudge. When you nurse something, you give it your energy, you give it your time, you give it your strength, you hold it close. It's like when you nurse a baby, you have to hold the baby close to nurse a baby. When you nurse something, it becomes a part of you. You talk about it every day. I think it's interesting in Deuteronomy 6:7, it says, repeat them again to your children. And what it's talking about in Deuteronomy is scripture. It says, repeat them, repeat the scriptures, repeat the word of God again and again to your children. Talk about them when you're at home and when you're on the road and when you're going to bed and when you're getting up. But here's my question to you. Do we talk about the scriptures of God to our kids, or are we constantly nursing and talking about our offenses? Can your kids repeat scriptures to you? Or do your kids repeat your offenses? Do your friends know about the love of God and His grace? Or do they know more about your offenses? Guard your heart above all else, because out of your heart flows from your mouth what's in you. And if you're carrying offenses, it will spew out all around you. Just like Herodias, she could have asked for half the kingdom and been a woman of great influence in that kingdom. But out of her offense, she chose the head of John the Baptist. What is oozing out of you? Are you offended? Are you living offended? If you are, you may be asking the question, okay, I'm offended. I'm living offended. Everything oozing out of me is my offense. So how do we get rid of our offense? You forgive. You have to forgive. You have to choose to forgive. Forgiveness is a choice. And that's why I wrote the book. I go into grave detail in the book, Moving Forward, on how to walk in forgiveness. And you can even go to c3church.com, and there's lots of sermons on how to walk in forgiveness. We want to get unstuck. Like Matt talked about last week, we don't have to live stuck. We want to get unstuck and move forward. And one of the ways that we do that is through forgiveness. See, God loves you. If anybody could be offended at us, it would be God. We don't trust Him. We don't obey Him. We don't love Him. We don't go to Him. We go to everything else. We put idols before Him. If there is one person who has the right to be offended, it is our God. It is Jesus. But why could Jesus eat with sinners? And why could Jesus do life with Judas, knowing he would betray him? Why could Jesus be around his enemies and not just kill them all? I mean, we carry an offense and we just want their lives destroyed, and we're human. You got to think about Jesus, how he would be around all his enemies, people talking bad about him and persecuting him, and he had the ability to wipe them all out. And yet he chose not to. How could he do this? Because the Bible says there was no offense in him. And I am here to tell you that when you choose to forgive and when you choose to get rid of the toxic emotions, there is nothing that can get a hook in you. There's nothing that can attach itself to you. You will find yourself walking through life not offended. It may stir up an emotional thing in the moment, but you're able to release it. It won't attach itself to you, and you will have the tools to get rid of it quickly and not live offended. When we are given the option for our purpose and our destiny, when we are given the option, hey, you can have up to half the kingdom. You can make an influence in your home. You can make an influence in your generational bloodline. You can influence where you live. When we're given that opportunity, do we choose the kingdom, or do we choose, like Herodias, our offense? That's just going to lead to nothingness, a head on a platter. What good is a head on a platter? It can do absolutely nothing for us. So today, I just want to challenge you, and I just want to encourage you, let's not live offended. Let's walk in forgiveness. And I know some of you are out there and you've had horrible things happen to you. You can still choose not to live offended. You can still choose forgiveness. And you are the one who will be free. See, choosing to live offended and angry and bitter and resentful, and the only person that's hurting is you. When you live with an offense and unforgiveness and bitterness, when you choose to hold on to it and live offended, it's like drinking poison and hoping it'll hurt everybody else. And the only person it's hurting is you. And so today, I just want to encourage you, take all your hurt, take all your offenses to God, choose to forgive and trust God. He is going to heal you. He is going to help you release all those toxic emotions. And He is going to be the one to help you walk unoffended and walk in freedom. And as you do, you are going to begin to live out your purpose, and you're going to begin to live out your destiny, and your life is going to have more value than you ever thought imaginable. Jesus came to give us life and to give it to us abundantly, and he wants you to live in that abundant life. So will you guys right now just take a moment just to search your heart? Maybe ask yourself the question, have you ever received God's forgiveness? Have you ever started a relationship with him? The Bible says that all we have to do to receive God's forgiveness is to call upon the name of Jesus and you will be saved. For it's with our mouth we confess Jesus is Lord, and it's with our heart that we believe. And so I just want to lead you in a prayer of just receiving God's forgiveness. And I tell you, that's the first step. As you receive God's forgiveness, then you have the capacity to forgive others and to release that to others. So if that's you, just repeat this prayer after me. Say, Dear Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross and making a way for me to come to God. I receive this extravagant gift and ask you to come into my heart and be the Lord of my life. I give you all of me and ask you to turn my life around for the glory of God. Forgive me of my sin and fill me with your spirit and help me to live the life you died to give me, in Jesus' name. And if you just prayed that prayer, I am so excited for you. You're even going to begin to feel differently as you release your offenses and as you begin this relationship with Jesus. It's the best decision you could ever make. And so if you made that decision, if you will just text Fresh Start to the number below, we have some information that we would love to send you and get in your hands, just helping you with your next steps on this journey to living, being in relationship with Jesus. Now is going to be a time for you to respond and just to hear God speak to you. And so there's a couple things I want to encourage you to do. As the worship team is going to come and lead us in a song, I want you to, number one, I want you to spend some time asking God to show you if there's anybody you've been living offended at. Maybe there's a person. Maybe you're offended at yourself and you need to forgive yourself. Maybe you're offended at God and you just need to tell him, and you just need to be honest with God that some of the way life has turned out, you're carrying an offense towards him. But ask him to show you. Sometimes we've lived with our offenses so long, they feel like they're a part of us. But if you ask God, show me who I'm offended at, he will, so that you can release it. And then I want to encourage you to light a candle. Maybe there's a candle in your house, and we do that here at C3 just to say, God, we're going to light this candle, and I want the light of Jesus to shine in this person. Or maybe you just light it and say, God, as I light this candle, I want your light to shine in me. I'm going to guard my heart, and I don't want offenses spewing out. I want the light of Jesus to spew out. So light a candle and just symbolically make that your prayer. And then we want to encourage you to take communion. If you don't have some bread and juice, you can run and get some, but we want you to take communion because it's just a reminder that Jesus' body was broken and bruised and his back was beaten so that we could be healed, so that we could walk free. And then as you take the juice, it just represents that it's his blood. It's the blood of Jesus that washes us white as snow. It's the blood of Jesus that allows us just to release offenses and to walk in freedom and forgiveness. And then I want to encourage you to send in your prayer request. How can we pray for you? We want to help you in this journey. So today, let's begin to deal with our offenses so that we can live out our purpose and our destiny.
Seas that are
shaken and stirred, can be calmed and broken for my regard. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me. Through it all, far be it from me to not believe. Even when my eyes can't see, in this mountain that's in front of me, will be thrown into the midst of the sea. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well.
Thank you.
through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you. And it is well with me.
What an amazing time of response that we just got to have, and what an awesome and powerful message from Pastor Martha that we just got to hear. We just want to thank you so much for joining us, but before we go, we have a couple things that we want to let you know about. You can go and you can sign up for a summer connect group right now. Go to c3church.com/connectgroups and get signed up for a connect group. And then also, this Wednesday night, we have Zeal Night. It's going to be amazing, so you can join us on Instagram Live at 7 p.m. Get your kids involved there. It's 7th through 12th grade. Get your students involved there, and they're going to have an awesome time. But right now, we just want to declare Ephesians 3:20 together over our lives. So you can repeat after me. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. God bless you guys. We love you.